acknowledge the land we are standing on in downtown Toronto as the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, the Chippewa, and the Wendat peoples. We also acknowledge that this land is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. This is how the City of Toronto recognizes hundreds of years of Indigenous history. When you acknowledge this land and its history, are you actually acknowledging? Do you know who these nations are? Were you taught about them in school? Do you know their individual languages, cultures, and histories? Do you know the true origins of this city? The history of this land is filled with deceit, betrayal, exploitation, struggle, and resiliency. This history is in public schools. It is spoken in courts. For most of the city, this is all they've got. But we know. And this is what we acknowledge.
The name is a powerful thing. It reveals something deeper about the place it refers to. And both history and a wealth of meaning. So do you know where Toronto's name comes from? This river was once a key source of food and travel for the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, and Wendat people. From Lake Ontario to Lake Huron, it supported game, trade, and the livelihoods of these nations for centuries. The fish were so plentiful. A large fishing river was built out the mouth of Lake Simcoe. Each nation called the river by a different name, but it was the Mohawks who called them to Toronto, where there are trees in the water. In the early 1700s, the French and English settlers used the word as the name of Lake Simcoe. After years of clerical errors on maps of the area, the word was anglicized and given to an area at the mouth of the Humber River. When the town of York was established, Lieutenant General John Graves Simcoe refused to name the town after an Indigenous word. Years later, when the city was incorporated, it was renamed Toronto. What are you acknowledging when you acknowledge this land? You're acknowledging that the very name of the city was taken from the Mohawk language and stripped of its meaning in history. One of the country's greatest cities, disconnected from its origins, we acknowledge its true history.
The right to live on this land called Toronto had been contested for hundreds of years prior to contact. The Humber River's value as a trade route, the fertile farming lands, and proximity to the lake made it invaluable to every Indigenous nation in the area. The British also saw the immense value in this land and were determined to gain ownership of it. In 1787, Sir John Johnston, the Superintendent General of the Indian Department, held a private meeting with Mississauga chiefs in the Bay of Quinte. Accounts of the promises made between the parties during this meeting have conflicted for generations. But eventually a deal was struck between Johnston and the chiefs. The Toronto Purchase was made. When years of border disputes between the Mississaugas and British threatened to escalate into violence, the British discovered that the deed of sale from Johnston was blank. It had no description of the land purchased by the Crown, no account of the amount paid for it, and the marks of the chiefs that agreed to the sale were attached on completely separate pieces of paper. It was an invalid treaty, and the land still rightfully belonged to the Mississauga Nation. The British bided their time to address the issue until the Mississauga Nation had been weakened by trade disputes and disease. In 1805, the British negotiated an underhanded treaty with a new generation of Mississauga chiefs for more land than originally proposed in 1787. 250,000 acres, Toronto to King City, sold for 10 shillings. Today, that equals $40. What are you actually acknowledging when you acknowledge this land? You're acknowledging the deceitful, manipulative, and exploitative tactics used by the British to secure title over these lands through Treaty 13. How can a treaty be honored if its very creation is dishonored? This land has been marked by tragedy since contact with European settlers. Wabakami, a Mississauga chief in the late 1700s, was well respected by his people and the British. Recognized as an accomplished diplomat, after a day of training with the British at York, he and a small group of his people camped under Sugar Beach. That night, a Queen's Ranger, Charles McHugh, companions set upon Bakunin's sister. Bakunin's wife called out for his help. He confronted the men, desperately trying to fight them off. Before help could arrive, McEwen and his companions assaulted his wife and fled the scene. They both passed the next day and were buried before any of the British had seen their bodies. Bakunin's murderers sent shockwaves through the Mississauga nation. They demanded justice.
No
faith! No justice! McEwen was brought before a grand jury where he was acquitted, as no British authorities had seen Bakunin's body before he was buried. Tensions reached a fever pitch. The Mississaugas allied with the Haudenosaunee, and the British feared a war was imminent. The British spent years manipulating and dividing the Mississaugas and Haudenosaunee, with disease and famine sweeping through their communities and their alliances shaken. Hostilities came to an end.
What are you acknowledging when you acknowledge this land? You are acknowledging that settler governance has systematically failed Indigenous people and responded to our cries for justice with intimidation and violence since before this country was even founded.
Fort York is seen as the birthplace of Toronto. Its establishment allowed the British to gain a foothold of power in the area to expand and develop them. But when American forces attacked the fort in 1813, Anishinaabe warriors were the first line of defense, laying down their lives to protect the British and the land from American rule.
Contributions will
whatever, it's all from outside this perspective. It's all is like, look at these Indigenous people and like all that they had to deal with. Don't you feel bad about it, but don't offer solutions. They don't offer like bring them into a contemporary aspect of what went on and are they still here? What's going on? You know, it's really placing people of color and Indigenous people in particular as like people who only suffer trauma, and there's no positive, and there's no way of coming out. When I thought about where this film can go, I was going to talk about land acknowledgement was a perfect way to kind of like go into that and really deconstructing this is what the real history is, this is what you're acknowledging, and this is how, you know, the act of acknowledging is in a lot of ways duplicitous, but in a lot of ways it can actually be positive if you really know what you're doing and what you're talking about. So I think once that kind of like key clicked in there, I was like, perfect, ball's rolling, we can get going. And because there is so much history in Fort York, it was tough to kind of like truncate it into that time span, but going in and being able, using the framing device of kind of breaking down land acknowledgement allowed me to jump around through time a lot and jump to these different stories that for me really stuck out because they were kind of emblematic of what we're seeing right now with like all of these social issues being addressed. The murder of Indigenous people that goes unpunished here, talking about land recognition, land rights that have been contested for, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years. You're talking about treaty rights, you're talking about literally just like erasure of Indigenous history in the sense of like even the names of Toronto and like certain key landmarks around here. They come from Indigenous names and Indigenous words, but people don't really know that. So it was a really like, for me, those were all the topics that I really wanted to tackle. And I wanted to also address the fact that, you know, Indigenous people still exist in Toronto. There are so many Indigenous communities that surround this area, but again, a lot of people just don't even think about that. That this is our history, and our presence here is still valid. We're still here, we're still taking space, we still exist. Well, I think when I was looking around Fort York, and I've been there like once or twice on like school trips when I was younger, but coming at it from fresh eyes, that was something that stuck out to me a little bit is, you know, Fort York actually does a fairly decent job at like Indigenous representation in their displays. But that one in particular, when you look at the other dioramas and the other mannequins that are even in that building, literally 5 feet away, they show a British officer looking very regal, very dapper, you know, like gun down by his side, looking off and everything. And then you look over and you see this Anishinaabe warrior in the most threatening pose possible with a knife drawn, like battle cry on his face. I was really like struck by that because to me, that really just kind of shows the issue of how people look into this history in a nutshell, essentially. So, you know, like, people always know, oh, Mohawk warriors are great warriors. You know, that's what they're known for. Mohawk people are known to be really great warriors. Anishinaabe and Mississauga people, it's like, that's the depiction generally of like a Hollywood depiction of Native people. That image has been permeated throughout history. And it was present there. And so when I was thinking about that, I really wanted to confront them in the sense of, I didn't want to be like, we're going to be in your face necessarily about it, but having a young Indigenous boy be like, I want you to walk in here, I want you to look at this thing and just like, see how it makes you feel, you know?
And he was brought before a grand jury where he was acquitted, as no British authorities had seen Wabakamin's body before he was buried. Tensions reached a fever pitch. The Mississauga's ally with the Haudenosaunee and the British feared a war was imminent. The British spent years manipulating and dividing Mississaugas and Haudenosaunee, with disease and famine sweeping through their communities and their alliances shaken. Hostilities came to an end.
I think the protest scene in the film that happens, it's protesting the murder of the Mississauga chief from the like late 1700s. But I wanted to use imagery that was super contemporary with like the signs and everything, so that you draw those correlations very easily. And you're like, I understand exactly what is happening here because I see this on the news, I see this in public, and I know that is exactly what they're talking about. And I know that this murder relates to all these other murders that have happened recently, and still nothing is being done about it. So it's that idea of drawing attention to the history that kind of has gone unchanged. You know, it's like those issues that were happening 200, 300 years ago still very much active today. And you can see that lasting effects of them. Everybody on the day felt exactly that idea of like, we're here and this is important and make sure that the story comes across properly. Because who knows when the next chance will be for people to address these issues here in this way.
Probably like a dueling blackboard that the Sterling Instinct speaks to now.
Mm-hmm.
Have a little chorus of people with ideas.
Yeah.
Those thoughts. Yep.
100%. Yeah, I think that's great advice.
Like, working with him and actually getting his feedback and his input in the project, I think, is really key because you see somebody who's like been doing this for a long time and trying to figure out how to approach telling these stories in ways that are digestible and in ways that also aren't like tethering you down and aren't like kind of like taming your voice, quote unquote. So hearing affirmations of like, yes, this is how you approach this issue, this is amazing, this is amazing to tell a story, I think they're super, super helpful. And knowing like, okay, somebody who is at that level who's been doing this for a long time still cares enough that they want to like give input to these younger filmmakers who are starting to kind of like flex their muscles a little bit and start to get into the industry. I mean, it means a lot, you know, that literature is like, okay, wow, yeah, there are people who are willing to really like help the next like generation of you know, marginalized filmmakers and people from different communities and people of color. So I think it was really great because it just gives you that sense of like, okay, yeah, I see you did it, I want to do it. You know, so getting that information, I think, is, yeah, really, really important.
Yeah, it's those moments, yeah, where you kind of put you down a little bit and you just get
it. But now is it in rabbit when it happens, move on it. That's having confidence with that idea I'm doing.